Okay, what the hell am I listening to? When does this happen in the podcast?
Now. Whatever you are listening to now is happening now.
What happened to then?
We just passed it.
When?
Just now. We're in Thrive Loud now.
Well, go back to then.
We can't.
Why not?
We missed it.
When?
Just now.
When will then be now?
Soon.
Would you like to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Speakeasy and Master Connector Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on this planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another spectacular, fantabulous, absolutely unbelievable episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond. Today on Thrive Loud, we have an expert in developing people and building scalable teams. She has interviewed, hired, trained, and led thousands of employees over the course of her career, most recently as the co-founder and partner of Cardone Ventures, a management consulting, joint ventures, and private equity firm. That's a lot of responsibility. That helps business owners achieve their personal, professional, and financial goals through the growth of their business. Her number one best-selling book, Teamwork, details exactly how she has built a highly engaged, highly aligned, and high-performance team in order to accommodate the business opportunity and growth. Thrive Loud listeners, we are going to have a kick-ass time here on Thrive Loud because I'm with Natalie Dawson. Natalie, how are you today?
I'm doing fabulous. That was quite the introduction. I love that.
This is kind of like how I make people feel really good to start. Listeners who listen to our program, I don't know, 800 some odd episodes in, whatever the heck we've got going on. Natalie, we got to make sure we bring up the energy level because I got to match up to somebody like yourself who has been killing it. And specifically with the adventures you've been doing. And here's what I want to do. Can you tell I've had a cup of coffee? I want to go back a little bit. I don't want to go all the way back to the womb. I want to go back to the point where this became your gig.
This became my gig when I unfortunately took an internship that I was not excited about. I wanted to continue to be giving back my time under these bridges in downtown Portland. I was very into just like donating my time to help people who were homeless and to have conversations with them. But my parents were finally like, listen, you're on our payroll and you have to start making some money. You giving sandwiches to homeless people is not going to get you any money. So they hooked me up with this internship and I hated the whole thing. It was like the worst experience ever until I stumbled upon this leadership content, which was about 2.5 months into the internship that I was doing. And the founder of the company had created this entire leadership series, and it really got me hooked on this idea of self-development, personal development, growth. And from that point forward, I got the bug. I got that self-development bug.
Okay, so you got the self-development bug. How did you help to develop others?
Yeah, well, I had to first develop myself, right? At the time, I was making $8.33 through my internship, and I was driving a 1993 Buick Century that was silver. It was my grandma's car that I inherited from her when she died. So I was just like, I want a nicer car. I really had my eye set on, what were those little tiny Mini Coopers? I was dreaming of those, Mini Cooper. Couldn't imagine what it would take in order to buy a Mini Cooper. And so I started writing down, hey, if I'm going to get a Mini Cooper, I have to make a down payment and how much money would I need to make? And so after I started writing down my goals and my manager asked me how to write down or asked me to share with her my goals, I got into this like, wait, if I could help other people do this, would I be more successful? And the business that we were in was already business consulting. And so the specific part I was working on was leadership development. And through the leadership connects to human resources and operations and marketing and finance, because all of those things are interconnected. And so it really was the foray through leadership that taught me the business side as well.
Okay, I love it. So there's making a decision that gets you on the path towards helping others. And then there's making a decision to help others recognize that you can help even more. Share with the listeners how you approached one of the people who's a thought leader in both of our worlds in connecting with Grant and creating Cardone Ventures, because that must have been a leap from what you were doing, which must have been just pretty awesome when you thought about what was happening between getting people to help people and now getting a much bigger platform to do so.
For sure. So to back up just a tiny bit, I was working in this management consulting company, and my then fiance, now husband, had just sold this company for a ridiculous amount of money. And what we were missing was, when you sell something or when you hit this goal that you've always wanted to achieve, what nobody tells you is you're still not getting off the ride at that point. And mm-hmm. we thought like, oh, we've made it, and now we're just going to sail off into the sunset. The reality was, I was 25 years old. I didn't want to retire, but when the thing that you've sold leaves you and it seems like a great thing, all of a sudden you have a loss of purpose. You have a loss of sense. You have a loss of yourself. And so here we had gone and helped all of these business owners, and yet we felt like, man, there's nothing left for us because this thing doesn't exist any longer. And so I was really searching for somebody to say, hey, going to the country club every single day and taking vacations and being on a beach is not the path. The path is continuing to create. And so I found Grant. I hated him at first. I was like, this guy has so much ego. I can't believe he's sitting on his private jet with his Gucci loafers talking about 10Xing everything and his Louisiana accent. But then I stumbled upon Elena Cardone's content and could kind of see Grant through her, because he wasn't just this caricature. He's like a family man, and he had all of these philanthropic efforts. And so that was what kind of that's how we found him. And it took me about 3 months of studying his content to finally convince my husband to be interested enough to start listening to him as well. And so we were really fans and showed up to a 10X growth conference back in 2019. And what was cool is our dream had always been, we want to help business owners, but we had always helped them in the audiology, which is hearing care, or ENT spaces. But we knew that these business philosophies transcended across other industries. We just didn't know what the endpoint was. So when we went to this event, there were all of these business owners in chiropractic and in the automotive space, and all of them doing between $2 to $5 million in revenue, but they were getting from Grant sales training. They weren't getting the business side. And so we went to Grant and said, hey, well, would you be interested in having a partnership where we helped people already in your existing audience grow and scale their businesses past sales training? And he reluctantly kind of said yes. And here we are 3 years later, and the business will do $75 million in revenue this year. And we've helped thousands and thousands and thousands of business owners grow and scale their businesses. So it's been a very rewarding partnership.
First of all, spectacular and awesome. And thank you for putting Grant in his place. But also what I will say, and this is an important piece, because we do this all the time on Thrive Lab. You know, we have a lot of people who are specialists in one particular area. And we recognize when, you know, you could be really good in that one particular area, but there are other areas to make businesses thrive. And whether it could be, you could have the best sales in the world, you better have really good marketing and good operations. You could have the best operations in the world, but you better be able to sell it and market it. And you better have a good culture within your organization to keep it running and keep the thing flowing. This is the balance of where people can really work on how they thrive, which brings us to something really important, which is, this is a common term known as teamwork. Did you like that segue, by the way? Listeners need to know, as you can hear here, you've written a great book here about teamwork. And by the way, I scanned through it, haven't gotten through all of it yet.
Okay.
But I would love to hear what inspired teamwork from the work that you're doing, and what's the key takeaway that listeners, that readers can get from it.
I love that. Well, yeah. So I wrote this book, Teamwork, because even though I was listening to all of this leadership philosophy and reading these books and taking these courses about leadership, when I had my very first team, when I was 22 years old, I had no idea what to actually do in the first meeting I had with them. I had no idea how to have a one-on-one. I had no idea what a performance review was like. I didn't know how to create a structure that actually worked to get employees to perform and to get them to buy into me and to buy into where our organization was going. And so I wrote it with that experience. And also after having hired, I wrote it when we had 86 full-time team members at Cardone Ventures in under a year and a half. And so I had just gone through this crazy period of my life where I had never been a recruiter before. I was never specializing in some recruiter school where they teach you how to do this. It was figuring out, just like every other business owner, how do you find talent in a time where the great resignation is taking place and all these other factors are at play. So with the real-time experience of just recently having to recruit people, but also remembering what it was like my very first time having a meeting and really coming up with what is the culture, what are the systems from a cultural structure standpoint that have to be in place for businesses to succeed. And so the book really follows this path of every single piece. I think of it like a puzzle, like every single piece is at play. And if you're not doing one of these things, it's going to be pretty clear why there's an issue that's presented itself. And I coach business owners on this every single day as a system, instead of, oh, I'm just going to decide to do performance reviews, or I'm just going to decide to do one-on-ones. Well, how does it all fit together? And how do you make a really successful culture that can also scale very quickly?
I love it. I want to double click down on this a little bit. And from your purview and what you see, what is the most common problem that entrepreneurial business owners, the people that you guys work with, have as it relates to operating their business?
It's always with their people. Always. Yeah. They think that this is the real challenge. They think that it's just Sally or that it's just Joe. Like it's one person. Oh, if I could just fix this one person. And what they don't see, I don't know if you've watched the show Ozarks. I love it. Where in the last season, they're talking about the casino and Marty is saying, I can make all of these assumptions when there's a lot of people and there's a lot of money coming through. But when there isn't a lot of people and is a lot of money, you can't quite see the disparities because you think it's everything's just a one-off instance. That's the same with small business owners. They think it's just Sally or it's just Joe and their random circumstances. Well, after helping business owners find thousands of employees and doing this myself, I've learned that things just aren't random. If you can put a system in place, you can actually avoid certain things from happening, lack of motivation, lack of hitting targets, lack of team engagement. You could fix that if you just had the right system in place. And so for me, my biggest hack with this is, okay, if we know that there needs to be a system, the fastest thing that a business owner could do and start really honing in on as it relates to their team is ensuring that every single team member has clear incentive plans and incentive payouts. Most business owners create it for their sales team. Everybody knows how to make more money in sales, but does the bookkeeper actually know what they can do that day in order to make more money? If they don't, of course they're going to lose engagement and excitement and the opportunity because it's the same thing every single day.
I've got a good question, and it's an interesting one because it has to do with the philosophy of Cardone and 10 times, right? There's a whole big thing about, you know, 10 timing yourself. And there's more to it than just the raw numbers and the growth aspect of it. But there are certain speeds that businesses need to run. And in some cases, obviously, you might need to slow down before you need to speed up, right? How do you make sure that you deploy excellent teamwork and operation tactics and incentives and plans and ways of thinking about people without getting distracted so much by the big number of trying to make the multiple of where the business is trying to go?
Interesting. Well, when you are focused on revenue and predominantly, you know, your sales and marketing strategies, what you find is you will be able to have and afford the resources that you need from an operating standpoint. But oftentimes people get so focused on, I'm going to make the perfect course, I'm going to have the best launch, and all of this work is done on the back end. They're losing money. They don't even know if the proof of concept is there. Instead of promoting it and selling it on the front end to see if there's market awareness, to see if there's some interest. And then once you have, this is like, if you're an ethical person, like ethics are important to us here.
I try to be ethical, at least today. Just today's Friday. Yeah, I'm being ethical today.
Well, I appreciate your ethics on this Friday. And I'm sure they're there every day. And most people are ethical. So if you are ethical and you sell a book to somebody that you haven't written yet, it's coming in 6 months from now. The fact that they have paid you for this book or this course or this product means that you will be ethically pulled to complete that project. instead, people just take this long amount of time. They don't tell anybody about their business idea or their new concept. And they take all this time into the equation when they could have pulled revenue forward, and then they could have afforded the resources to actually put together those things. So often it's just backwards. People just.
Yeah. I love asking guests this question. I want to see where this goes, specifically authors like yourself.
Okay.
And that is, when you set out to write a book, you have a certain goal and intention for what it should be for the reader and for yourself. What was the happy accident or the gift that you received in putting together TeamWork?
Really good question. You should host a podcast. You know that?
Isn't that so funny? Thank God I do. Oh, wait. Yes, I do. All right, here we are. But no, it's a serious question, and a good way to stall them for you to think about the answer. It's okay. No, there's always a gift, right? There's something you went in with some intention, something that you wanted to get out of it, something that you knew others could benefit. But when you go through the process, the writing, the development, the marketing, all this stuff with it, something happens. Mm-hmm. What's the surprising happy accident that you experienced?
I don't know that there was a surprising happy accident. To be honest with you, I didn't set out the goal to write a book. I set out the goal to finish a book. So I wrote the book within 2 weeks. And I think that that's a trap a lot of people fall into, is they just put time into all of this stuff. And for me, it's like, I want a handbook for people to understand, how do I actually lead and run a team successfully? And so I knocked it out in 2 weeks. I didn't want it to take longer than 2 weeks. I didn't want to write a book for a year. I wrote it in 2 weeks. And since then, I think the rewarding part that continues to happen that I didn't necessarily think would happen is people actually implement it. And so I just finished a course earlier today. I was speaking to a group of people, and one of the guys said that his dog, he's a dog trainer, and his dog ate his book. I was like, well, clearly you're not doing very well on the training part. But he told me that he had implemented 3 or 4 of those things. And to me, that's like the ultimate fulfillment. Is it's not just like a fluffy, happy book. It's very tactical. And when people use those tactics, it makes that all worthwhile.
Yeah. It's the sense of when somebody comes back and either regurgitates it back to you or thanks you, or a sense of appreciation because, one, you connected with someone else with something that you did, but you also helped somebody, which is always really cool. Yeah, I like that.
Isn't that the point of writing the book? That's why I was like, I don't know if it's an accident, because if it didn't do that, then it totally would have failed.
You would think, Natalie, that would be the point, that most, as you said very nicely, most ethical, good-hearted, open people who want to help others. But there's a lot of people who write books for different reasons and don't really know it. This is just an unfortunate piece of
I don't hang out
across.
With people. So
there you go. We only hang out with the cool people.
Exactly.
I love asking guests this question, Natalie. Every listener at Thrive Loud is going to be excited to hear your answer here. Look, you've been from a very young age having a drive, having a car that you didn't want to drive, a motivation to be successful at a really young age and turn something over in a very short amount of time based on the span of your working career. You have been thriving on most days. Mm-hmm. But we all have those days when we're not kicking on all cylinders, when the Wi-Fi isn't working as well as it should, when things are just not flying. Listeners will understand that happened beforehand. Natalie Dawson, when you have trouble thriving, what practice do you seek, or maybe which individual do you seek out to get yourself back on the thriving track?
Yes. Grant Cardone is always my number one go-to. I listen to the 10X rule to get myself back in that mindset, because I know I agree with it in theory, but in that moment, I don't agree with it. I have to do a workout. If I don't do a workout, everything else feels off for me, but that discipline of doing it resets me to make other good decisions. But if I'm not being good with the workout, I don't know why it's so intrinsically tied to the other type of work that I do, but I really do feel a sense of completeness, a sense of discipline when I complete a workout. So it's listening to Grant. It's probably listening to Grant while forcing myself to go work out, because for the longest time, I couldn't force myself to do those things. I would make promise after promise after promise to myself. Oh, I'm going to go do this. Oh, I'm going to go do that. Oh, I'll follow up with this person. And I wouldn't fulfill on those things. And so now I can really rest on, I know I'm a disciplined person. I've demonstrated that. And I have to just get back into that specific discipline of working out, and then Uncle G's 10X rule.
I got to tell you, I always feel like eating Cajun food whenever I hear him, but that's a whole other story in another podcast.
Do you know that he also eats the tail?
I've heard this, and I got to tell you, that just doesn't work in my stomach. Let's do the admin part of the show, Natalie. We're going to go to Fun Street. Share with the listeners all the places people can find out about you specifically, TeamWork, Cardone Ventures. We will put it all in the show notes, but our very active social media listeners and avid podcast fans want to hear it directly from you.
Well, you can go to cardoneventures.com/teamwork and you can get a free copy of TeamWork there. I am also most active on Instagram and TikTok. Instagram is at Natalie Workman. I can't figure out how to get my handle changed. I am technically a Dawson, but it's still a Workman. And then TikTok is super fun and we're creating a lot of great content there for the Natalie Dawson.
Yeah, try having an actor with the same first two parts of your name and my name. Come on, you know, you've got it. It's okay. It's real rough.
Yes.
Natalie Dawson, are you ready to go down Fun Street?
I'm ready. We've been on Fun Street. Where have
we've been on Fun Street the whole time. Now we are going to the HOV speed lane, right? Like, the one that you could pass. And which is rare because I know you're in South Florida and there's always a lot of traffic. So what I want to do now is get a glimpse of what you're all about from your personal life and stuff. Is there a movie that connects with you or one that you love to rewatch that's on? Whenever it's on, you got to go see.
I am a huge Love Actually fan. It is my favorite movie. Hugh Grant dancing down the stairway just cracks me up every time.
So I was going to ask you, there are 9 sub-stories that are all overlapped in that movie, by the way. 9. Which of the 9 is your favorite? Is it Hugh's story or is it another?
No, it's the Keira Knightley story.
With the sign, the guy with the signs, right? Yeah.
The sign where she thinks he's in love with her husband, but it's her.
Yeah, it's pretty good. I can't tell. It's either the Portuguese woman story with, you know, just in cases.
Oh, yeah.
Or the little boy running through the airport, which is like a TSA nightmare. I've heard stories of kids who've tried to like imitate that movie, but that's a whole other story for another day.
Well, and that was back before 9/11.
No, it was after. It was
oh, wasn't.
Yes, it was just after. So yeah, I looked it up. I was like curious myself, but it is great. We've had but you know what's interesting? In the last this year in 2022, you're like the third or fourth person that's picked Love Actually. It's kind of weird. And I guess it's also on a lot, which is true. Okay. We're going to do the speed round here at Fun Street, Natalie. I'm going to ask you something. I want the first thing that comes to your mind. Okay. These are things that lift you up, motivate you, make you feel good. Basically, they make you thrive. Love. Ready?
Okay.
Of late, a song you love to listen to or one that pumps you up?
Vegas by Doja Cat.
Ooh, I like it. And we got recent ones, too. That's really a good one. She's an interesting one.
If you haven't seen Vegas, you have to see Vegas. Elvis. The movie's Elvis.
I think that's what you meant. Okay, got it. Elvis, but don't, I will check it out. I'm on it. I heard the Elvis movie is awesome. I got to go get it. Favorite food that is not a dessert?
Pepperoni pizza.
Favorite dessert?
All of it. Sour Patch Kids.
Sour. Hold on. Sour Patch Kids. That's the one that you got the sour. That's like, but my mouth makes a face when I eat one of those. It like it squirts up like that, you know?
Isn't it the best?
It's not my favorite best, but it's yours, which is what this is about. So exactly. Sour Patch Kids is your go-to dessert. An activity you wish you did more of?
Swimming. I love going in a hot tub and just like swimming around.
Gotcha. You doing laps in the hot tub?
Yeah, kind of. More like that.
Immersing yourself in water. I like that.
Exactly.
An activity you wish you did less of?
Answering emails.
Yeah, we do a lot of that, don't we?
Yes.
Natalie Dawson, if I could snap my fingers and you could be anywhere in the world, where are you?
I would be at the Amalfi Coast in Italy.
Oh, very nice.
In a hot tub, ideally eating Sour Patch Kids.
Thrive Loud listeners, you got to check her out. Natalie Dawson, all the social handles, Natalie Workman, the Natalie Dawson, whatever we're trying to get for her. Cardone Ventures, check out TeamWork. Truly a pleasure to have you on the show. Really a lot of fun connecting with you. And thank you for everything that you're doing because 10 times freaking rocks. I'm a big fan.
Thank you for having me. This has been amazing. And I'm looking forward to connecting with you further in the future.
You got it, Natalie. And to all the listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone. You gon' feel it for 2 weeks when I release you in them streets and keep my knee in discreet. Keep the clean in my jeep and put that Yeezy in your teeth. Let my deeds off their leashes if you even think to speak. I'ma give a whole new meaning when you said you live in a dream. We could keep it sleeping. You gon' live with all your G's. Count them sheep, 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 sheep. Time by
T-H-R-I-V-E-Z-Z-R-I-P.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.